Hi, good morning, everyone. Morning. I'm Minyi, the pastoral intern, and today I'm really excited to share God's word with everyone this morning. So we're starting our sermon series on the epistle of Galatians, as you've seen in the video earlier. It's written by Paul, and we are going to explore why the gospel matters in this series. So let's look at today's passage. It's on Galatians chapter 1, verses 1 to 10. We have it on the screen, but I'll be referring to different verses from time to time. So if you have your Bibles with you, digital or hard copy, please keep them open. I'll be reading from the NIV translation. Paul, an apostle, sent not from men, nor by a man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead, and all the brothers and sisters with me, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to rescue us from the present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you to live in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel, which is really no gospel at all. Evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion and are trying to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a message other than the one we preach to you, let them be under God's curse. As we have already said, so now I say again, if anybody is preaching to you a gospel other than what you accepted, let them be under God's curse. Am I now trying to win the approval of human beings or of God? Or am I trying to please people? If I was still trying to please people, I would not be a servant of Christ. This is the word of God. Come, let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your precious word. Open our hearts, our minds, and ears today as we learn from the scriptures together. Holy Spirit, give us the mind of Christ and soften our hearts as you instruct us in our learning. In Jesus' name, amen. So when I think of the Singaporeans' ability to fight for something worthwhile, I think of our national pastime, which is to queue up, join the queue, right? Last year, people queued overnight for the release of iPhone 14 and also Swatch Omega. Does this sound familiar? Yeah? So the crowds were really, really big. And then years and years ago, McDonald's had a collectible of Hello Kitty, right? And that also had like a massive queue. So at the same time, when I think about, you know, what Singaporeans like really fight hard for, I also think of parents who are doing everything within their power to make sure that their child gets into a school of their choice for P1. Yeah, so I heard that the application is coming up soon, right? So they do things like volunteering, and sometimes they will even move closer to the school to try and maximize the chances of their kids getting in. And for those of us in the workforce, I think it's also securing a job with good prospects. We prepare for the interview, we network, and we do all we can to increase the likelihood of landing the job. And when we start work, we work to secure a certain career progression. And for the students, like the youth over there, they study hard to do well and to get into a course of their choice. So as Singaporeans, I think we hustle hard. We work very hard to secure a hope for our future. What would it look like, though, if we fought just as hard for the gospel, which has both present and eternal implications? The title of today's sermon is to hold fast to the gospel, something worth fighting for. So we're going to take a look at Galatians to understand why this is the case. Okay, so earlier on, we had an overview through the video that was shown. But right now, I would like to invite everybody to imagine for a moment that you are Paul. You founded the Galatian churches. You've been teaching there for about 2 years. And it's been a couple of months since you've left Galatia, only to realize that a group of false teachers, the Judaizers, an extreme Jewish faction, they have infiltrated the church. And they are teaching your people, your church members, your Galatians, the wrong things. And they were saying that Gentile Christians had to submit to Jewish laws and traditions in addition to believing in Christ to be fully righteous. So it's a direct contradiction of what you've been teaching for the past 2 years. Would you be frustrated? Yes. Thank you. Interaction is good. Yeah, I would be frustrated as well, right? So the question is, why then were the Galatians paying such attention to the Judaizers? So a little bit more context, okay? At that time, the first converts and early Christians in the Galatian church were Jewish Christians. And as Jewish Christians, they struggled with a dual identity. So on one hand, being Jewish was their national identity. And because they were Jews, they were constrained to being strict followers of the law, such in the Torah, such as circumcision, eating kosher food, right? But on the other hand, their newfound faith in Christ invited them to celebrate a holy freedom of not being legalistic and observing the law. And it was a freedom that they have never known. So when the false teachers shared their version of the gospel of straddling both Judaism and Christianity, it didn't sound completely wrong to them. In fact, it sounded like the best of both worlds. And so many of them were listening to them. And I thought that if I were the Galatians, if I were part of the Galatian church then, I would probably be confused as well, right? And I'll also be trying to figure out, okay, what's really happening now. So with this significant and concerning development, Paul wrote Galatians to defend the truth of the gospel by refuting the Judaizers, the false teachers, and calling the believers back to the pure gospel. So actually, Galatians is a letter on apologetics. So I'm sure many of us have heard of the term apologetics. It simply just means the defense of the faith. And Paul is a master at apologetics. So I urge you to read Galatians thoroughly together with us. It's an exciting book. It moves quite fast and it's only 6 chapters. So today I will cover 3 main reasons about why the gospel is worth fighting for. So the 3 main points are, number 1, we hold fast to the true gospel because it is of and from God. 2, we hold fast to the true gospel so that we will not be led astray. And 3, we hold fast to the true gospel because we are to please God and not men. So reason number 1. We hold fast because it is of and from God. Now, to understand why it is of and from God, we need to take a look at Paul explaining his authority as an apostle. So at that time, because the Judaizers were discrediting Paul, and because they were discrediting his apostleship, by extension, the gospel was also at risk. So he had to defend himself. So this issue of false teachings and accusations discrediting him was such a paramount and such an urgent importance that Paul skipped the customary greetings which are commonly found in his letters. Okay, so a quick like Bible quiz, a little pop quiz here. When you read the letters of Paul, do you realize that his greetings are actually quite long? So he actually typically has several things. So it's a paragraph expressing commendation of the local church, thanksgiving, benediction, and prayer. But all of this, if you look at the Galatian letter in the first few verses, you'll realize that they are not there. And in fact, he just cuts to the chase because this is such an important issue. So how does he execute his defense? So firstly, Paul addresses the issue of his authority head on in verse 1. In the very first verse, he begins by saying that he is an apostle sent not from men, not by a man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father. So the term apostle refers to an envoy or delegate who is sent to carry a message or enact a mission on behalf of another. So what this does is to call immediate attention to the awareness of a sender. And in this case, Paul is saying that he was appointed by a divine sender, and his appointment is not a human one. And it's none other than God, who had previously sent Jesus Christ. So this emphasizes on his direct authorization by God to act as an apostle of the gospel. So Paul goes on to expand on his apostleship from verses 11 to 24 of the chapter, which Pastor Jeremy will bring us through next week. And so this tells us that Paul is answerable only to God. And if he was only answerable to God, why then would he be trying to please people as accused by the Judaizers? So he blows the accusation right out of the water. And number two, this tells us that the gospel is a divine revelation because of its divine source, and it sets it apart from all the false gospels of that time, and specifically the false gospel of the Judaizers. And secondly, Paul defends his authority and the gospel through the shared testimony of a Christian community. So let's look at verse 2. It says, "All the brothers and sisters who are with me." So this verse is a way to remind the Galatians that Paul's message is not his own invention. He didn't cook this up. But it's the shared testimony of the larger Christian community. And this Christian community includes the apostles. And Paul is also saying that his teachings are in accordance with these apostles. So who are these apostles? They are people like Peter, John, and James. And these are apostles who were there with Jesus, and they had witnessed his death and resurrection. So if the believers in Galatia were questioning Paul's apostleship, they were also questioning all the other apostles. So he has essentially verified the divine source of the gospel. And when I was reading this, I was thinking, okay, so why is he doing this? What's the point of him establishing his authority? It's to set the stage to address false teachings and false teachers so that the Galatians are not led astray. So how do we know if something is true? In order to know what is false, in order to know what are half-truths or twisted truths, we first need to know what is true. So this brings us to our second reason for holding fast to the true gospel. We hold fast to the true gospel so that we are not led astray. Verses 6 to 9 is a stern warning and a word of caution from Paul against the issue of false teachings and false teachers. Charles Spurgeon once said this: "Discerning is not knowing the difference between right and wrong. It's knowing the difference between what is right and almost right." So if I can use an analogy, it's like traveling overseas and seeing a restaurant which sells Singaporean food. So you're a little bit homesick, right? And you're already craving some Singaporean, some Asian flavors, but being the discerning foodies that Singaporeans are, we're all a bit skeptical, like, is it going to be good? But then you're like, oh, okay, I just really want to eat something that reminds me of home. So you go into the restaurant, and much to your delight, you see chicken rice on the menu, and then you order it. So when it arrives, you masterfully balance a slice of chicken or like several slices of chicken meat on your rice in your spoon before you dip it into the chili sauce and put it into your mouth, expecting it to taste amazing, only to realize there is nothing like the real deal. The chili sauce is chili jam. The rice is plain rice, right? The travesty of it. And it's not the one that is bathed in the glorious aromatic chicken fat, ginger and garlic. It just doesn't taste like your usual favorite five-star chicken rice. Have you all tried five-star chicken rice before? No? Okay, it's very nice. I can try it. So how were you able to tell that chicken rice wasn't authentic? It's because you are well acquainted with the OG, the original chicken rice, right? And it's the same thing for the gospel. Paul refers to the false gospel as a different gospel, which is really no gospel at all. And it's interesting because of how he's chosen to word it. It's the idea of how a subtle twisting of the truth is more difficult to spot than an outright lie. It is passing off what is almost true as true. So it's more important, it's all the more important that we know, that we anchor and abide in the Word of God to discern what isn't the gospel truth. Okay, so what characterizes the true gospel, the good news? I think many of us are familiar with it. So just a quick recap. What is salvation? Salvation is not dependent on human effort or adherence to the law, because Jesus fulfilled the law when he gave himself on the cross for us. And two, salvation is the grace of God and freedom in Christ. And how does that compare to the Judaism's version of the gospel? It's the complete opposite. It's a dependence on human effort and adherence to the law, because the Gentile believers had to follow the Jewish laws and customs, right? Salvation also becomes a reward for certain deeds. And it's not a gift of grace. This is a twisting and an undermining of the gospel truth. It's saying that Jesus' finished work on the cross is insufficient. So the Judaism's version of the gospel was to move grace back into the law and abandon liberty, freedom, for legalism, for works. And hence, their version is a perversion. And in verse 7, the word perversion means to turn about, to turn into an opposite character. And in Greek, it actually means to reverse. So in other words, the Judaizers have reversed the gospel. They had turned it around and taken it back into the law. So it's not actually good news. It's bad news, right? It's bad news because the Galatians, who had begun their Christian lives in the Spirit, are now reverting back to living by the flesh and their own resources to earn salvation. So here, this is Paul addressing the Galatian church in AD 48. What about today, AD 2023? What are some false gospels that we hear about? So let's look at some examples of the characteristics of false gospels. So some false gospels, some characteristics are things like the rejection of core beliefs like sin and salvation. They could have a low view of Christ, which means just viewing Jesus as a moral teacher, teaching you good from bad, and he is not divine. Or it could be moralism. Being a good person is enough to go to heaven. Others include things like believing that Jesus is not the only way to God. Everyone can go to heaven. Some will say things like, the Bible is not inerrant. The Bible is not infallible. It's also incapable of mistakes. Some don't believe in the virgin birth. Some don't believe in the Trinity. And the list goes on and on. But the truth is, false gospels and teachers, heresies, they have existed in the church for millennia, especially in the early start, in the early church. So that's around the start of Jesus' ministry. That's AD 27 to about AD 325. That's the early church. And so since then, they have just gotten rebranded with new names, new labels, or they are packaged differently with different strands of like false of like characteristics of false gospels together. So, which is why what's being said now is hardly new. And that is why the church settled the core beliefs of the Christian faith in a creed. Now, the purpose of a creed is to provide a doctrinal statement of correct beliefs or a statement of faith for us as Christians. We are known as a creedal people because we follow a creed. And creeds were usually drawn up at times of conflict, or like at times where there are heresies and they want to address all these false teachings. So an acceptance or a rejection of a creed will serve to distinguish the believers and the heretics. So heretics are people who believe in heresies, right? False teachings. So there's this one creed in particular that we use a lot in church. What is it? Nicene Creed. Yes, very good. In fact, we just recited it earlier, right? So it's the Nicene Creed. We read it often, and it's certainly for good reason. Why? It is the only true and reliable ecumenical. Ecumenical just means united, universal statement of the Christian faith. And it's accepted by the Catholic Church, the Eastern Orthodox Church, the Oriental Orthodoxy, the Church of the East, and the Protestants. It was adopted in AD 381 to refute heresies. At that time, there was a predominant heresy called the Arian controversy, but yeah, you can go and Google it and read out about it later. So what this means is that this creed has been passed down for 1,642 years. What we believe today is the same as what the early church believed in. So that says a lot about the authenticity of our beliefs, okay, that we are on the right track, where we believe in the right things. So that's always comforting to know, right? So moving forward, when we encounter false teachings and we're not sure how to make sense of them, we can actually refer to the Nicene Creed. Nicene Creed is actually very detailed. And we can refer to it to help us to evaluate and to distinguish what we're hearing. Okay, so, but then what's the big deal? Why is this serious? Just how bad is this issue of false teachings and false teachers? And the answer is varied. It's gravely consequential. Paul tells us that false teachers are destructive and they can lead us astray. Just as the subtle twisting of the truth is hard to discern, false teachers can also be really difficult to identify. Paul said that even if he or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one they preach to you, let them be under God's curse. If an angel came preaching another message, he would not be from heaven, no matter how he appeared. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 13 to 15, Paul warned that Satan masquerades as an angel of light. So we must be on guard and we must be discerning. This is so serious that Paul calls down divine judgment upon any who turn the good news of Christ into something that it is not. He denounces the Judaism's perversion of the gospel by pronouncing them to be under God's curse in verses 8 and 9. And he says this twice to underscore the gravity of this sin. If we look at the Greek term, the Greek definition for being under God's curse is to be devoted to destruction. And this curse is not an ordinary curse. It's not, you know, what we're used to. It's not cursing and swearing. But it refers to the most severe kind of judgment and damnation. There are other instances in the Bible that explains and emphasizes on the severe judgment of false teachers. One of which is 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1. But false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. Which echoes the judgment mentioned in Galatians. So if we believe false teachers and false teachings, we are exposing ourselves to great harm. And this is not to say that we shouldn't go and understand what are these false teachings and get a firmer understanding of what they are, but it's about believing them. So if we believe in them, we are exposing ourselves to great harm. And Paul is warning the people of God to have nothing to do with it. What does this mean for us? When we read Christian books or articles online, when we watch online sermons, or when we listen to Christian podcasts, we have to do this with a discerning mind. We have to compare what we are hearing, what we are reading, with the truth of the Bible, which means that we really, really have to have a solid grasp of the Bible, what it says. And we have to read the Bible for ourselves. There are many false teachers and there are many false teachings out there. And sometimes, untruths, what is fake, is mixed in with the truths. So that makes it even harder to detect. So we cannot accept everything that we read as the gospel truth. So remember how I mentioned earlier that Paul was defending himself against the people pleasers at the beginning? He rounds it up here. Our final reason to hold fast to the gospel is because we are to please God and not men. Verse 10 reads, "Am I now trying to win the approval of human beings or of God? Or am I trying to please people? If I were trying to please people, I would not be a servant of Christ." How do we know that Paul is not trying to please people here? Firstly, he didn't try to sugarcoat the gravity of the false teachings and the false teachers to the Galatians. In fact, he was very direct, he was very provocative in the way he rebuked and warned the Galatians. So this phrase, "I am astonished," is actually a formulaic way of rebuking in ancient letters. So it shows that he's upset, he's angry, and he's actually not timid about causing offense for the sake of preserving the truth of the gospel and making sure that his converts walk in line with the truth. He had disciplined them out of love. Like, why would Paul go to that extent? Paul really cared for the Christians in Galatia. And he did this out of love. And if he wanted to please everybody, including the Judaizers, actually it's just easier not to have resisted the teachings of the Judaizers, but just to agree with them. So if he had done so, he would have been received more favorably by everyone. Instead, he took great pains to set the record straight, and in the process, he refuted the Judaizers so severely by invoking divine judgment on them. So to please God, Paul was really faithful in the message that he delivered. He didn't compromise on it, even though it was difficult to deliver it. He was not a flatterer who would tell an audience what they wanted to hear and win them over by compromising on the integrity of the message. Paul understood that being a people pleaser is incompatible with being a reliable servant of Christ. He only wanted the approval of God. And what about us? Do we only want the approval of God? Do we seek to honor God? If we think that Paul is only fixated on making the gospel known and he doesn't care about the interpersonal relationships, the social dynamics, nothing could be further from the truth. He was well aware of the challenges where the gospel is concerned. And we see more of this as we progress through the book of Galatians and even in the other letters that he has written. The warm and lengthy greetings that he has says a lot about his heart for people. It is possible to please God and one's neighbors at the same time. It is a good thing. But Paul is demonstrating to us that sometimes a choice must be made. Sometimes the less palatable things need to be said in order to provoke necessary changes. Paul wasn't causing offense for the sake of it or simply to protect his reputation, but he was fighting for love. The gospel message which speaks of God's love for us so that we live in freedom and in his grace and empowerment. And this is Paul's demonstration of how the gospel was most certainly worth fighting for. So what does this mean for us? Paul's own example challenges us to remember that in every encounter in every decision, in every intervention, there is one whom we must please. There is one to whom we as Christ's servants are answerable. We hold fast to the true gospel because we are to please God and not men. Earlier, I shared about how we as Singaporeans are really good at fighting for things that we find worthwhile. A lot of what we do is to secure a hope and peace for a certain future for us and for our loved ones. But the gospel that we have all been touched by in one way or another, which is why we are in church today, right, continues to offer us an unshakable hope, a confidence, a peace for all circumstances and eternity. I was touched by the gospel when I was 13 years old. I was a student in Fairfield, and I was sitting in the hall one day listening to chapel. And I still remember that day the pastor was Pastor Elvin Chan, and he shared the message on God's love. And for some reason, I was just so touched to know that there was a God who loved me so much, a God who gives me a hope for a future, that I teared up. I just knew then in the most inexplicable way that this God is real. At that time, I wasn't a Christian. Yeah, it was my first time in a mission school. I was like, every day got devotion, every week got chapel. I keep singing songs. But I was so moved by that message that day, that there is a God who loves us and who gives us a purpose. So I raised my hand to accept Jesus into my life when the pastor asked. And there was this unusual but comforting warmth that I had never felt before radiate throughout my body. And after that day, I felt different. And as my relationship with God deepened, and as I grew in knowing God's word, I learned that our Heavenly Father fills our days with purpose. Our hope for a certain future is secured in Christ. The gospel tells us that the grace of God permeates every area of our lives. He gives grace for all our days, and we can trust Him at His word, what the Bible says. The gospel tells us that we are not only saved for an eternal life, but we have been saved for a relationship with God. And that is why the gospel is worth fighting for. When I was preparing for this message, I sensed that God is addressing some of us specifically not to give up on Him. God knows and sees you, you who are standing on the brink. Let Him speak into your situation through the Spirit and His Word. He knows exactly what you are going through, and He loves you so much. So come, don't give up. Don't give up on God. So a quick summary, a quick recap. Hold fast to the true gospel, because it is of and from God. It is divine. It is supernatural. Hold fast to the true gospel so that we will not be led astray. Let's grow in knowledge and discernment. And finally, hold fast to the true gospel because we are to please God and not men. We give God an account for our lives. Come, let's pray. Heavenly Father, help us to abide in You and put on the mind of Christ, to live by the Spirit and by Your Word. We are saved for a life-giving, a joy and peace-filled, a hope-inspiring relationship with You despite the challenges and the anxieties. Give us understanding, give us discernment, and revelation that we may grow in conviction, in the knowledge and love for your gospel. Give us the courage to number our days with the desire to honor you most. In Jesus' name, amen.